One sec. Okay, speak.
Hello.
Okay, I can hear you.
Okay, good.
I have to disable a certain device for it to work. Alright, what are we looking at? We are looking at...
The Thresh game. The free 7/12 Thresh.
Okay.
Right. I have no idea how to support at all.
Alright, so this thing about support... Did I tell you about... Did I rant to you about what it's like to play support? Yes or no?
Nope.
Okay. Alright, how confident do you feel in your laning phase? Like, actually answer me that question. How confident do you feel in your laning phase?
Like, as a solo laner?
As a solo laner, yes. Actually, that
solo
answers
laner,
my question.
I'm perfectly fine.
Okay. So, what is this? Second anniversary quest. What are these jobs? Oh my gosh. Okay, so... The thing with this laning and what it's like to being a... How do you feel about the support role? You need to answer me that question now.
I feel like a chicken with my head cut off.
Yeah, it's pretty rough, right? So, first thing...
I'm doing. I'm just always terrified being like, what do I do?
Yeah. So, supporting is basically... The concept is pretty much straightforward. You just set up kills. You're like utility. So, alright, 0-0-0. Is this a remake? Remake? They open mid? What the, who? Why? What happened? Oh my god. Oh my.
They rage quit.
It's fucking sad. Okay, so what I was going to tell you was it's a very straightforward concept. Basically, everything that you do in the laning phase, you do as a support. The only difference between you doing that in the laning phase and as a support is that you don't, and I repeat, you do not CS. Everything you do is now towards everything except for CSing. That's the gist of it. That's all you do as a support. You do everything that you do in as a laner that's not a jungler, and you just support. You just don't CS. So we're going for the Thresh game right here.
Yep.
So the reason why I say that is because when you support, mm-hmm. everything you do as a laner, right? So as a laner, you trade. So as a CS, I mean as a support, you gotta trade. Like
right.
every kind of laner trades. I've already demonstrated to you how to trade efficiently. You harass them when they're CSing. You do that as a support too. As a support, you got a ward. Well, as a laner, you got a ward too. Like every single laner should do it. There's no excuses for that. Every single laner knows how to manage their mana, knows how to fucking initiate fights, and not know when to take certain fights. You do that as a support too. You just know like, okay, maybe now I could do it. You gotta land skill shots, just like a laner. Any laner with skill shots, you know, any champion like that. And most importantly, you gotta roam and team fight. Every single laner does that. Support does that too. Like, what? There's everything you do as a laner, you just don't CS. That's it. You just get lower gold. So what? If you're behind, you have low gold and you have to play off of that too. People have won from behind. So there's really no excuse to be playing support badly. It's just decision making. That's it. So the first thing is that you don't take you take either exhaust or ignite on Thresh. When it comes to punishing people, exhaust is fine. In this team comp, exhaust would be most optimal because they have they've got a triple AD triple AD and only double AP, and you can't really kill anybody. Like you can try to kill the Zyra, but she won't flinch. Like if you're up against Zyra, she's just gonna try to dick you like every single second she gets. Therefore, the damage output that she throws out there is much higher than the damage output that you will retaliate with. Henceforth, the ignite being completely useless. It's not a worthwhile summoner spell for you to invest in if you're gonna fight. So exhaust is actually the only counter to her. And the exhaust is the counter to her because, well, it's more about cutting down the Jinx or cutting down the Fiora that gets onto you or cutting down the fucking Kha'Zix that jumps on you. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you just have to find the right target, and that's pretty much it. And then the next thing that you have to be aware of is the fact that on their team comp exists a zillion. So ignite is pointless at that point because even if you kill somebody, you got to do it again. And so it's like, wow, rip. Okay, so the first thing you did was you skilled up your E. That's fine. That's completely normal. I'll be uploading your Ahri, the Ahri session from like a week or two ago. I don't know how long it's been, but my computer is finally fixed so I can finally render this stuff. All right. So yeah, the heal is also rendered ineffective, and the reason why it's rendered ineffective is because when you use the heal, excuse me, when you have heal and they and both people use heal at the same time, the heal cut is halved, so it's not as valuable. All it does is just reposition you. Anyway, yes, that's fine. Your auto attacks are fine. Ward this bush immediately when you're playing support. As an AD carry, you should be warding this bush too. It's very important because, like, you can see when Zarya comes out and does shit like this, she should not be leveling up E level 1 because she should be leveling up Q. Q is much more efficient. As for you, wait till your passive comes up and start whacking CS whenever you can. And if you whack CS, like, it allows you to get your targets off. Oops. So you hit level 2, or he hits level 2 because he came to lane first. That's fine. Just stay. Don't walk too far ahead without vision. Hence why I told you to ward this bush here. This bush is kind of awkward because they're not in a position to advance forward like this. Because Lee Sin could always easily gank them at level 4, so they can't walk up like all willy-nilly. Plus, your team comp has a Lee Sin itself. Like, your team comp has Lee, right? So, in theory, you should have warded here at around 4 minutes. So, but normally, that's if you're against Lee. And the reason why you do that is because if you're against Lee, Lee can solo dragon at level 4. But literally nobody in the game knows that he could do that at level 4. So, since practice tool is out, even though I don't use practice tool, you can test it out yourself. It's like, Lee Sin has the capability and threat of soloing an Infernal Drake at level 4. If he can do that, then, like, you know, because that exists as a threat, that's literally a free dragon. Like, wow, I just got Infernal Drake with no contest. Like, what the fuck? So, you should get in the habit of warding it if you're ever up against a Lee. Now, in this case, you have a Lee, so you should be emphasizing, yo, you can just take this at level 4. Try not to walk too much up to harass. Against a Zyra, you basically lose lane. Like, you can fight her and stuff, but unless you land your hook and she doesn't drop a plant on top of herself when you throw a hook out, you can win the trade. But other than that, you will lose all trades. Like, her damage output is always going to be higher than you. You land a flay, you land a hook, that's Colossus, that doesn't matter, you still lose the trade. She just straight up hurts. Okay. Alright, just hit Zyra, okay, now you have to hit Jinx because she's closer. And then this is the problem with double heal, because, like, with double heal, both of you guys don't really get, like, you see that, like, all that HP, like, oh, I thought I had double heal. It's technically, like, 1.5 of healing, because your heal is diminished, right? So it's like if an allied heal is used, their heal is diminished by 50%, see? Right? if healed by an allied summoner, like another heal. Either it's another heal, or, like, if it's all healing. I'm not sure how it works. Sandbox mode is out there, but we'll have to figure it out. This guy's name is Bitch. Alright, that's pretty interesting. So, when you heal again, it's either, like, you know how this heal gives you 50% to an ally? And this healing is half for units recently affected. Restores 105 health. Oh no, it heals the full amount. Yeah, so if you cast heal on yourself, he gets 105, but then he casts it at the same time, so he gets 50. So therefore, your healing is only, again, 1.5 efficient. So therefore, you're not getting, like, two separate heals, you're just getting one heal each, or one and a half of a heal. So the value of heal is extremely valuable in this game. So if you had exhaust, you would just exhaust the Jinx so she doesn't crush him. Or you can exhaust the Zyra so that she doesn't crush Ezreal either, because Zyra's damage output is going to be higher. She's out of mana, though, so you can take advantage of that. Basically, the goal of your combination is to walk up, reverse flay them back into you. They'll attempt to either counterattack, or you just hook them in the face and they can't move for, like, 2 seconds. Lee Sin is bottom, so what you can do is you can't really bait it out unless he's actually committed to coming to you. And if you look at the map, he's actually doing Krugs, which is kind of obvious. So you can't really fight. Not until he decides to ping that he's on his way. If he doesn't ping that he's on his way, it's fine. You guys should not be fighting 2v2 when you're, like, with this low mana and this low HP. You can't afford to be fighting 2v2. Just because she's out of mana, she has a lot of HP, she's actually a big You guys are basically your laners are basically big creeps, except for you. So the difference is her creep is, like, she has more HP. Like, that's pretty much it. She just has more HP as a big creep. So, you can't afford to fight. If you land a hook, the only reason you guys are gonna fight is because Lee Sin's there. There's no reason to force a trade here. Hit it with targets. Be careful. Now get it. Yeah. So when she goes up to harass, you have two options. You may dodge it. First of all, you gotta dodge it. But flay her backwards. It's you can also do a really neat trick with flay. It's very hard to pull it off against the Jinx because her animation is really freaking weird. But, like, against the Varus, you know when he cocks his arrow and he shoots the arrow, right? You can flay him while he's cocking the arrow, and it will cancel his auto-attack animation, therefore making him have to reset the whole cock thing. So he'll pull back his arrow, he's about to shoot, you flay him, he's like, oh, shit. So then he'll have to do it again. So you basically make it so that their attack is completely nullified. And so, like, you could do that with Jinx when she's about to fire, but it's really hard to tell because, like, you know, her bullet coming out is, like, kind of weird, you know? Okay. Lantern the Lee, if you can. Like, you gotta Lantern the Lee so that he doesn't have to do this W. The reason why is because Lee Sin, in your ELO, he's either a great player, like, mechanically, or he ain't. And in this case, because he just did that, well, there's two options. It's like a flowchart. So if you Lantern him, he didn't have to W to Ezreal. Because what he can do instead is to maximize his efficiency if you Lantern. What he should be doing is he should be taking your Lantern to close the distance. Then doing his ward hop to get really close in case that they flash. Then queuing them because then they have no flash after. Or he just hops to you guys. And then he has to use his own flash to close the distance. And then he has to use his Q. Like a lot of it comes down to patient play. So now he flashed, right? So this is where if he took your Lantern earlier, he would ward hop. But now, as a result of this, you guys can chase. One of you guys is going to end up flashing because there's too many minions here. See? I knew somebody was going to have to flash. Like, somebody has to flash. There was no way you guys could have just walked through all these minions. Because by that time, you know, you knew she has heal because you guys lost a trade earlier. It's too predictable. And then he lost his Q because he has to move. He didn't flash, okay? And that's a secured kill. Unless, no, there's nothing that happens. See, now, if he has his W, it would just be a ward hop. Nobody needed to flash there. E? No, it's down. Just hit the bitch. Wait, Lee Sin died? No. Why doesn't he have his red? Must have been jacked or something. Or no, it ran out. See, right here? Okay, so flash is Zyra. So you stop. Looking at Ezreal's health, he doesn't seem to be healthy. But again, Lee Sin can solo Drake. Okay, Lee Sin is actually kind of retarded. He built the jungle item first. I value damage. If he had built damage, 100% guaranteed that dragon would have been yours uncontested. 3v2, even though numbers-wise, it's kind of bad because it's like more like 2.5 and like big creeps. So it's like two champions and big creeps. But if he had two longswords instead of buying the jungle item, you guys would have been able to do drag right there for free. Because Zyra is in no condition to contest. And Jinx is dead, so she's at base. Kha'Zix might be invisible, but two champions and a big creep are strong enough to take down a Kha'Zix and a dragon. If Lee Sin can solo the dragon, which means dragon becomes irrelevant. But that existed, and then the only thing you played wrong there was having to flash forward. You did not need to flash forward. I mean, I knew somebody was going to flash, and it should have been Lee, but he moved down to the side and shot a Q, which he didn't shoot a Q immediately as soon as he W'd in. So that's kind of awkward, because the point blank Qs are hard to dodge. So, he should have, if I did what he did, he should have taken the lantern, get a point blank Q, wait till they flash, Q back in, or take the lantern, ward hop forward, because you know they're going to flash, because they don't have any other choice, and then QQ them. But he launches a long range Q, which could be dodged. Right there, because Jinx didn't dodge it, that's what resulted in her death, but, you know, she could have dodged it. Like, it becomes predictable at some point that he's like, oh, Lee Sin's going to Q, and then you kind of just move. I played a game where I was like, I dodged like 6 Lee Sin Qs in a row, and I was like, this guy knows how to do every single Lee Sin Q at every single predictable moment. It was freaking hilarious. I think it was this morning. Wasn't I playing this morning? Let's see. I'll just have to check that real quick. Definitely wasn't this game, right? Let's see. I'm just gonna check it while we're watching. Okay, so you bought a Sight Stone and a Sweeper. Okay, good. That is actually really, really valuable. That is correct. There's nothing wrong with that. No, it was a game yesterday. I was on Swain. Okay. Yeah, you see what I mean? Like, she wins all trades. She has Thunderlord, so therefore she definitely wins all trades. She has a pen. She doesn't run cooldown because nobody in their right mind would ever run cooldown when they don't need the cooldown. Instead, they just need damages. So your goal, you maxing hook, good. 2 points in flay, 1 point in hook, good. You're doing exactly what I told you to do. So your goal in this laning phase, survive. You're playing a skill-based lane against a non-skill-based lane. Like, Jinx has to right-click you to death, right? She doesn't have to cast any spells. You have to, every single player on your bot lane, aka you and Ezreal, You guys have to land skill shots. All Zyra has to do is land. It's the only person that needs to land skill shots is Zyra. Like, Zyra on their side. But you have to land your skill shots. Ezreal has to land his skill shots. So if you all miss, you guys are just nothing but big creeps. But Jinx is like a super creep. You know, like, you know what happens when super minions push a wave? Like, they just shit on the wave. So it's the same thing. Exact same concept. Don't try to look for blind hooks. And the reason why you want to do that is because if you looked at the map beforehand, I knew Lee Sin was coming. Now you don't have a hook. And then this is kind of an awkward lantern. Don't lantern for souls unless you like, because like the value of a soul doesn't really fucking matter. You can get a soul from kills or from minions later on safely. This is a really dark lantern in the sense that like it's like you waste a lantern because now Lee doesn't have a way to close the gap, because like look right here, he can close the distance. But judging by the way they're moving back, it's obvious that it's warded. This is a solid ward hop, but you can't follow up. So this is going to be a... Okay, he has ultimate. The best thing he could do is... Wait, he just has to do a QRQ and he kills both of them. Flash this way, R. Q? What? See? What? Oh my god! He had like 12 opportunities to destroy. Okay, first of all, R flash knocks both of them up, pull a Bubba Kush, you fling the fucking Zyra into knocking these people up. Therefore, she stands here. You know she has no flash. You know she has no flash. There's literally no escape. You push it back here. This allows you to close the distance between her. This allows Ezreal, who has Arcane Shift 100%, to close the distance too. Your lantern is down. That doesn't matter. Your hook is down. That does matter. But you have Flay. You get close. You have heal. You gain distance. Use your heal. Force your heal. You know that she doesn't have heal because she used it later than you guys, because like earlier, you should have timed that, by the way. You remember when Lee Sin initiated the first gank? You should immediately have timed to heal and flash. And in that order, because she flashed first, then she healed, and then Zyra flashed. So in order of summon spells, their heal might come up sooner, but like they're not gonna be up at the same. They're not gonna be up at the same time. Like, heal will be up first before flash. But you know both of them are down because it hasn't been at least 3 minutes yet. It's like this has been like maybe a minute and a half before the next gank. So anyway, if he flashes, this would be okay. You want to flash for objectives. That's usually what the goal is. Flash to secure something. It has to be worth it. If I were Lee, I would have actually. First of all, I would have been better than this. Second, this E is kind of redundant. Like, this means nothing. Because you're already in range. All you have to do is R flash forward. This way. 100%. First of all, you dodge these. These become irrelevant at that point. She wastes mana. That's good. She animation, like, stutters because she has to drop these things. You knock both of them up. You give your teammates a closer way to get to you. And then after that, Zyra's back here. You don't chase the Zyra. You can continue to... You can Q, R flash her. And then queue back forward, because then you'll be over here, and then you're still in between both of them. But, like, you can then cripple both of them simultaneously, and this is terrible. He should have queued anyway, because even if he gets snared, he's still on top of them, and he still has flash. This is fine, but at this point, you have to make the best of what you got, which is forcing a flash. How do you miss? Oh my, I totally forgot that. Exhaust is down. And then, see, the reason why I advocated for flashing right there, flash kicking right there, because this is why people can't play Lee at this level. You're either a god on Lee or you're not, and this is clearly, like, just because the gank was successful doesn't mean it was the cleanest. So, if you did it more cleanly, or if this Lee played it more cleanly, this results 100% this objective. Since you guys didn't take it initially after you killed bot lane, now, again, you have the opportunity to do it right now. Just Ezreal tanks it for a little bit while Lee Sin uses W to sustain himself. Then you guys got it. Again, you guys can 3v1 the Kha'Zix. You have two heal. You have one heal now, but you guys can 3v1 the Kha'Zix. Only thing you could have done better. First, don't blind hook into the Fog of War. Like, you have to look at how the wave was going. If you do land the hook, will Ezreal sacrifice a lot of farm to get like a successful trade off? Is that trade worth the farm that he misses? And almost all the time, if you're being pushed under tower, the answer is no, because Ezreal is still behind. Despite him going 0-0-2, being ahead in CS is more important because farm is more relevant to Jinx. Like, Jinx can scale better with farm than Ezreal can. You know what I mean? Like, because Ezreal is a mate, like a caster AD kind of champion, like he's an AD carry, but not like a traditional auto attacker AD carry, he doesn't scale with farm. He scales with like on hit items. Yes, gold is valuable on him, but gold is more valuable on Jinx because all she has to do is right-click people to death. There's less room for error. She doesn't have to fuck up as much. Whereas Ezreal, missing skill shots like that really obvious Q that I said, how do you miss? Those things are room for errors, which means his DPS overall, he can lose DPS. So therefore, gold on him means more to your team, yes, but gold on Jinx is 10 times more effective. Because she can just run you guys down, and you guys, all she has to do is dodge one Q, and Ezreal's DPS is gone. So like, the value of CS for trading again, this is why I say just survive in this laning phase. You guys don't have to force fights unless the gank comes by. The value that Ezreal farming is good, yeah, but trading and losing CS for trading, not worth it. Never. You can't afford to have Ezreal fall behind no matter what. Look at his mana too. Always look at his mana if you want to try to trade. Never trade when he's, like, completely out of mana. Because if he Qs, he can't escape. If he ults and he has no mana, can't escape, man. It's all about his escape. If he escapes and he still gets caught, first of all, he sucks. Second, you're kind of done after that. But you understand, like, Zyra can afford to burn all her mana and shit on Ezreal. And Ezreal can't do anything about it. You can't do anything about it either. All you can do is just hook them away. You can try to fight, but it's not going to work. So instead, this is a farm lane until Lee Sin comes. Lee Sin came twice, that's fantastic, but of course he could have played it cleaner. And then, see, like that, yeah, like, this is, we're not trying. Look at all these minions right here. If you guys did manage to fight that, like, nothing good comes out of it, because you'll miss a lot of farm, because that farm is equivalent to the amount of kills, you know? So it's not the same. And the reason why this lane is so, like, farm-centric is only because, like, the meta revolves around it. Had it been, like, a Janna or something, I would start forcing a little bit more trades. But, like, Janna's kind of rough to kill. If it's, like, a Sona, that's free. If it's, like, a fucking Alistar, that's free. You guys are gonna fight, you know? Like, there are lanes that look to fight you, and you gotta think, like, is your kit strong enough to counter-fight them? And the answer in this case, I don't think so. Judging by how much damage you take compared to how much damage you can dish out with your bot lane, with the whole room for errors and the skill shots part, they come out on top almost every single time. Even if they don't cast spells, they probably still come out on top if they just dodge your spells. Because Ezreal's base attack speed is significantly lower than that of a Jinx's attack speed. She's at 1.3, and she can ramp up x3, like you know, more. Whereas he's at 1.9 as long as he lands a Q. But if he misses all his Qs, therefore, no damage output. Plus, you back with a tier. That's not damage. Like, that really isn't damage. So therefore, if Jinx backs with the same amount of gold, she can get two daggers, so her DPS is higher. You know what I mean? That's actually really fucking amazing right there. That's actually really good. Nice.
What nice. Is?
You put the lantern there, like, that's a psychological tactic. Like, you just like, oh shit, there's a jungler there. Notice how they backed up? Keep that. Don't do that a lot. Like, it's because if they... You want to do it when the jungler is in Fog of War, especially. It's like if you do it while they're top lane, I mean, like, if they have any sense of map awareness, in which case you can't assume whether or not they have map awareness, but, like, if they do have map awareness, then they're gonna be like, fuck, this jungler's here. It's just that if you do it too many times, like, they can, like, oh, it's just a bluff, and then, you know, shit like this happens. Because now you don't have don't Q? Okay, yeah, that's fine. Oh, I thought you were gonna walk up and flay. That's fine. Let it go. You're gonna have to let it go. I mean, that's fine. But you guys can't look for more. Your goal is to not die, because if you die, they're going to try to secure the objective, the Infernal Drake. This is dangerous. I feel like somebody has Deathfire Touch with all those fires, but it's actually just Blood Moon Thresh. Seems that you're building Redemption. Am I wrong?
I don't know. I don't even know what the hell supports even build.
Two Fairy Charms and a Regrowth Pendant. Those are components towards what the fuck did I just say?
Redemption?
Yeah, Redemption. They're components for Crystalline Bracer and Forbidden Idol.
To me, they're still components for Morellos.
Wait, what? Fairy Charm?
Used to be.
Oh yeah, Fairy Charm and, well, Regrowth Pendant, I don't think so.
No, just
the Fairy Charms, and yeah.
Forbidden Idols.
Sad part about this is actually, to be honest, I think you could have taken Ancient Coin Start, and the only reason why is because it's a poke lane. You just sustain yourself You'll get more gold, and then that's you have the value. It kind of depends on what you value, and personally, I still value move speed on this team comp. The only reason why is because you guys gotta escape their shit. Like, Face of the Mountain might shield you and stuff, but, like, they either 100 to 0 you, or you don't live long enough to teamfight. Your goal is to escape. Zillion's gonna catch you guys no matter what. He just speeds up Fiora, and Fiora runs at you. Jinx gets speed up, she runs at you. You gotta counter that speed somehow. It's the only thing I can advocate for. Plus, it gives you early game sustain. Because, oh my god, please don't E like that. Jesus fucking Christ, Ezreal. She had a snare ready, she would've been dicked. To be honest, like, he can't be affording to do that kind of... Like, look, now look at, like, how afraid you guys have to play until... Oh, shit. Well, that's the only time I would advocate ulti. And never mind, it's down. Lantern him. The only thing that you should have done is lantern him right there. Okay, now you guys are going to get 2v1'd. Nice play. Auto. Rip. So, oh, okay. So, if you lantern him right there, he can get on top of the Jinx, which means that he has less room of error for missing his skill shots, because your guys are on top of each other. The only problem with doing that is you'll take a little bit more damage. And the reason why is because, A, if she has rocket form, you're going to take, like, you know, AoE rocket damage. And you're going to take Runan's Hurricane damage. And if she has minigun form, you're just going to take damage and Runan's Hurricane damage. However, you guys will kill her sooner, because she's going to panic. And then, of course, you'll get out... Because Zyra was zoning her. So, therefore, like, he takes excess damage from Zyra, but you could have prevented that by lanterning him immediately. Plus, he gets a shield. So, therefore, well, maybe that if he gets a shield... Well, if the shield broke because of Zyra, and then you got dicked on by fucking Jinx. You know what I mean? Like you can pull the guy to you. That's what happens when you land the hook. Usually, you only fly in if you're going to have, an ulterior motive. Because, like, generally, the best thing... Because, like, you're over a wall right there. So you can't really walk up to her because the hook will die out before then. So you hook her, and then you fly in and toss the lantern back, keep your mouse around the same vicinity, and then flay the dude. And then that'll allow you to, one, get the flay off, two, you'll get a lantern off, three, you're going to be absolutely melee range, then you box them, and then you try to kill them before anything else. It's hard to say, though, but, like, I think lanterning him right there was the most optimal. Of course, whether or not he clicks it is another problem, okay? So now you guys decide to do Infernal Drake, even though you guys could have done it at fucking, like, 5 minutes in the game. Really, Lee? Really, Lee? You didn't have your Q up? Are you kidding me? Close. Good redemption. Oh my goodness. Flame back. Nice. Edge of the flay, though. Fire the Ezreal Q. Nice. Okay, so don't assume that your hooks will land, simply because, like, think about your hooks, like, really slow. Like, this is a critical skill. It's like landing your charm. It's a critical skill shot. Like, missing it actually kind of screws over your entire team, in the sense that your team is actually relying on picks. You have two options to play this. You may wait till Lee Sin gets a kick, in which you flay, then Q. You may just walk up, flay them, or, like, in the same sense, you could just flay them, and then you throw the hook, because it's harder for them to dodge it if you're slowed. Or, you do the patient move, just wait for Lux to snare them, then hook them. That's it, they can't move. Okay. Upgrade Ruby Sightstone, I value Ruby Sightstone, and then after that, you go lock it, and, Frozen Heart. Frozen Heart's really good. The reason why is because they got a Jinx Fiora that's instant counter. This way you'll have a 40% cooldown reduction guaranteed. And then you can definitely get Face of the Mountain, which will then allow you to sell your Ionia Boots into a Ninja Tabby. Tabby, whatever you want to put. Yeah, Ninja Tabby. So 3, 4, 5 items. And then your 6th item would be ZZ Rob Portal, likely. Actually, no, your 6th item would be a Locket. How dare I forget the valuable item. In theory, you can also get Banner of Command, but that's not really worth it. Like, Fiora and Jinx could just walk up and kill it. It's not really worth it. Don't hook under tower. Don't fight under tower. Again, if you fly in or you walk up, you're going to get into trouble because, like, if the tower is going to, like, punish you. Ward that bush. Somebody needs to ward that bush. If anything, use your sweeper on that bush right away so you know that you're not getting ganked. That's very crazy. Oh, that was very close. Close... Lol?
Yeah, I have no idea what I'm even doing.
Okay, so first thing is, when you play Thresh, your movements on your mouse have to be extremely accurate. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't mess up my flash plays unless, like, if I mess up my flash play, I'll know I'll mess it up before I even, like, finish the, like, I'll flash, and I'll already mess up the flash, I'll mess up the flay, and I'll know when I mess it up, when the flay isn't even out yet. It's just, like, you have to play Thresh a lot to understand, but, like, the flash play should be almost instantaneous. So right here, if you're gonna flash, the optimal flay was not this way, but this way. And the only reason this is, like, this, I don't know how this hits. Like, I do not understand how this hits. Like, your hitbox is right here. I don't get it, but whatever. Anyway, the most optimal flay is always to hit both of them. So you flay them this way. This way, they get pushed back this way. She gets into a wall, so she's basically stunned. But she gets pulled back, too. This way, your teammates have, an easier chance to get to it. And then second, the box would also entrap them in here. Because then they have to walk through two walls. They're always going to, no, now she has to walk through one. This is a good hook. And this is a good flash by her. But this is a really good hook. This is like a solid, solid hook. But the other way you could play it is if you look this way, then hook the Zyra. Because Thresh doesn't turn. So that way you guarantee the kill on Zyra, but it's fine. This Lantern would have had to come out automatically. You don't have exhaust, you don't have ignite. So your mouse should never be over her. You shouldn't be auto-attacking her. She's too far out of your range unless you have, like, rapid fire cannon. But she's too far out of your range. This is the closest target. You always want to focus the closest target when you're supporting. And the reason why is because the closest target will most likely be going on your AD carry. And as in this case, she's dicking on everybody. Well, until she kills herself. But that's not her fault because you know that she had no flash. Oh, you should not fight this. Good dodge. Oh, you get the jinx. Oh my god. That's fine. Not fine. Did he just flash? He just flashed. I can't believe I just witnessed that, and I can't believe it just worked. That is hilarious. Lee Sin, really? You didn't do a full range ward hop? You did like a half hop? Jesus. I mean, I admire that he ward hopped, but you have to ward hop all the way. It's actually a lot farther than you expect, but like, still, dude? Like, shit. Like, I'm talking, like, you can queue a minion, warthop, and flash from here to the tower. Like, that's full range. With using your flash, your max Q range, your flash range, and your W. Like, to kick someone back. I've seen it done before in a montage, and I was like, I tested it, and I was like, holy shit, your mobility is insane. I never knew that the warthop range was actually that long. So, he's not playing Lee to his maximum potential. Like, there are some instances in which you don't max range warthop, and that's when, like, they're not, like, you don't need to, but like max range ward hopping is like really important. So this is not good. First of all, the thing with your champion is that you can't last hit, so therefore it's irrelevant. That's me being blunt about it. It's like there's no point in getting it because like it just means you have to try three times as hard to last hit instead of doing twice as hard because like you know your AD doesn't execute it. It's whatever. So. Getting it just grants you more HP, but that's irrelevant because you can just get Kindle Gem and just leave it like that. If you're getting Locket, it's still fine, but if you get a Ruby Crystal, you can translate it into either a Kindle Gem, which is 800, or a Ruby Sightstone, which is also 800. So I value more wards. Because by the time you get into lane, you'll always place three of them, and then you'll have one for... That's really awkward. Yeah... Okay, so they traded lanes, and the reason why they're trading lanes, and the only reason they're doing this is because they know that their bot lane is ahead, and they should try to translate their lead. You can't fight that. Okay, with the redemption, maybe you can. The only reason I will advocate for not fighting... Wait it out! Q! Oh my god, no way. Almost. Yeah, I have to run. Nice. I'm glad that you knew that he was going to Q you that way, because that's the only way you could exit. Now, if you were smart... He would drop one here, that way you literally have to walk all the way around and you'll just walk back into the team. But he obviously didn't expect you to walk up, because the most predictable movement is to walk back to base. What the fuck? I saw that, I was like, Good job using the sweeper to detect champions. Very, very good. So everything that you do as a laner, you're doing here. Like, all these fundamental core concepts, the only thing you don't know how to do is, like, just when to fight and when not to fight and stuff like that. That's just trading. Wait, okay, so the Q was, the secondary proc Q was unnecessary. I was just gonna say you should Lantern the Ezreal, then make your Q. try to throw your hook, like, try to use your hook not for the sake of hooking or using a skill shot. Remember, don't treat it like an Ezreal Q, treat it like an RE charm. Lee, please ward hop. Never mind, it's on cooldown. Awful.
I feel like you hate this Lee.
You're either Spenu Flawless, SBK Flawless, Peanut, every Lee Sin Insect, or you're not. Like, I hate my Lee because, like, there are millions of things. I do not, for example, I don't max range ward hop. I don't Q ward hop away from something. Q inwards, flash R. I don't Q flash R, knock a Jinx back into, or knock a Zyra up in the, up back into the wall, and knock up Jinx at the same time to disable two people, get two kills, and get an Infernal Drake for free. I don't, you know, like, do all these things, but, like, these things have to be done. Like, you have to see the champion creatively. That's the only way you have to play, you know, Lee. As for Thresh, the only thing is, like, there's offensive supports, carry supports, and defensive carry supports, but Thresh is a three-dimensional support. You have multiple different ways to play him, and missing the hook doesn't guarantee that you lose everything, because you still have your Flay and your Lantern. However, if you miss your Lantern, then you miss your hook, you're actually almost like a big creep at that point if you don't have ulti. So your goal is to not be a big creep. Like, oh my gosh. You don't max Flay second, you max the Lantern second. Reason why is because more Lanterns and bigger shields. Very important. Bigger shields, always helpful, but also more saves. Always, always, always in critical. 2 points is just for the laning phase, just to increase your chances of last hitting. That's it. Nothing else means more. Really.
So what's the point of redemption anyways?
What do you mean?
Like, literally, why do I buy it?
On support, so, like, the stats that it gives, the fact that it's a big AoE heal, it's really good. It also gives you more shield power. Since you took heal this game, like, you might as well use it, right? Like, lol. Because there are supports out there that don't build, what's the name of it? Ardent Sensor. Ardent Sensor gives a lot of, you know, shield stuff like that. Oh, kill this bitch. Nice. Oh my god. So, Ardent Sensor gives you a nice shield bonus and stuff like that, but not every single support will build Ardent Sensor. So you gotta upgrade your shield strength somehow. A lot of the support items do that. So Redemption does that for one, and that's really valuable. Second, AoE heal is huge because that can potentially save everybody. That can save people, that can kill people, like snipe. I've sniped someone with a Redemption the other day. I literally called it like, oh, I got the snipe on the Redemption right here. And it was hilarious. The stats for it, it's just so cost efficient. Like, it's barely 2,000 gold, and it's like one of the most, like, it gives you a lot of HP. It gives you HP that's on par with a fucking Sightstone. It gives you CDR, which Locket no longer gives you CDR, so basically kind of makes up for your Locket. And then it gives you regenerative stats. So overall, oh, and most importantly, you can use it while you're dead, but not a lot of people, like, take that into effect. But you can use it while you're dead to save somebody from far away or something. So it's like, overall, it's too valuable to not have. And people that don't build it, like, are usually the carry supports. But even then, like, the carry supports will build it later. Carry supports as in Zyra and Malzahar. You need it on every support. Except for those two I mentioned. You build it last. This Zillion is you. I don't know why he has the item. To be honest, he needs Morellos.
Oh, are you talking about the Lich Bane?
Of course I'm talking about the Lich Bane. You know it! God, let's put people on Lich Bane, honestly. Like, the only TF and, like, fucking Victor need it, really. And Lulu and Fizz, like, God.
And Ahri.
God, go away, dude. Jesus. Okay, press O, I'm gonna press H. Oh, that was a really close hook.
I mean, you can proc it 6 times.
This freaking slow is terrible. Oh my god, his ward hops are slow. They're either slow or they're like on point. Like, he only had one on point ward hop, but that was really important. Like, okay, see this Kha'Zix right here? So, like, what Lee can do is if he has ulti, if he queues this and then Jinx walks in front of Zillion, that's a kick. But I don't think he'll ever see it. and you can't kick the Zillion into your team. He'll just bomb himself and you guys take double explosions. You can't kick the Fiora into the team because then that's gonna give him her an opportunity to try to delete the fucking Ezreal. The only person you can kick onto the team is Jinx. Don't stand this far back unless you're looking to lantern someone to safety. But you guys should be on the advance, like going forward. You should be popping your sweeper too. And the reason you should be popping your sweeper is because the reason why they like they have a lot of like they'll ward out here. People will ward out here and stuff like that. Just to detect it and ward over this wall, like. Not, like, here, but, like, over towards the right more, because the tower, if the tower sees it, you're kind of fucked. But you can always, like, ward towards the left more if you want to bait them into attacking the ward, which will allow you to land a hook while they're attacking the ward. So it's your option, but you should ward over this wall so that we see that people are coming through this gate right here. Because before, you know, that gate didn't exist, but now that that gate exists, everybody has to play around it. This rotation is actually really fluid. But you sacrifice your top. Awful.
Yeah, I've been like so terrified this whole game. I had no idea why. Like I literally just.
It's not about your hooks. It's not about your hooks, by the way. Like your hooks are looking to catch somebody to try to kill them to try to win the game. That's not all Thresh does. First, that's a problem. If you have redemption, you should probably use it. Like you guys can't siege, so you should not use it. You should just base. But what you should be considering is, like, if they get onto your carry... There's only two people that can get onto your carry. It's Kha'Zix and Fiora. Hook them away. You hook on top of them and then move away from your AD carry. Because wherever you're standing, you tug them twice forward. So therefore, you're tugging them away from them. Kick. That's how it's done. See? Like, was that so hard? Like, if you figured out how to do that, like, my god. Stay on top of each other. That's really hilarious. E. Lee Sin's out of energy. Lamel.
Why do I feel like this Lee Sin is like me and just puts like a blindfold over himself while he's playing and pretends he's good?
Cosplaying IRL gives you extra strength.
Oh, really?
Holy shit, they have literally four control wards. I've never seen a silver team, like, or gold team do that. That's actually insane. What the hell are they afraid of? Like, you guys don't even have stealth. My god, they're just buying wards to buy wards. Like, like they should be warding Baron, they should be warding Drake. Like, if they're gonna do this kind of shit.
So, from what I'm getting out of this is I need to start cosplaying Victor and Ahri.
Why would you cosplay Victor? That's actually really hard. Like that means you have to like destroy your body or some shit, I don't know.
Or just get a whole lot of fucking cardboard and spray painted silver. The discount cosplay.
Yeah, when you laser them, you're gonna like you're gonna squirt water, dude. Like, we're too poor to actually have lasers, so you just shoot water. Of course, you're probably gonna miss the lasers, like the water's just gonna, like, spill flat or something. Or it's gonna go backwards, because, like, that's how it works. Because, like, bad victors will shoot the laser backwards, and it's like, oh my god. What a beast. Good shit. Okay, so you shouldn't be here. You should not be here. No, this is a problem. You should not have gone down this way. This is a pointless rotation, because this is happening. But the only reason why this rotation will work, and the only condition that you have for this to work, is because you're planning on doing from here to here immediately after, which it's fine. It's just that the thing is,
Could be better.
What the fuck? Well, with blue buff, you can throw more hooks at the expense of your mana because you just regen all that mana. Therefore, if you group with your teammates, like if you group with your teammates, you're gonna be throwing more hooks than you would normally throw due to the amount of mana that you have and the cooldown that you have. Which, in turn, means more chances at getting a pick. And you shouldn't be thinking that you're... Just pretend that you're Janna or Ahri in terms of strength. You're actually really weak. Like, not even kidding. Like, you should not be assuming... Remember that you don't get armor scaling, so you just pretend you're weaker than you really are. That's why you play... That's why I play backline Thresh. I don't... Or midfield Thresh, where I stand in the center. Because
so don't treat... So don't treat Thresh like a tank.
You're not supposed to try to
treat him like Maokai.
Yeah, you can treat him like a tank if you build tank, but in this situation, when you build him traditional style support, you're not a tank. You should be playing him like your goal is to, you can peel, but you can also like hook people, but hooking someone doesn't mean you fly in on them like that. Like that, you don't need to do that. You can just reverse flay. Cuz it, the only reason you flying into them does anything. Oh, that was a sick flay. The only reason flaying someone does anything is because like, or flying into someone, it just increases your probability of landing the flay. That's it. But you shouldn't be flying in for doing crazy ass plays or flays, because it's not necessary. Putting yourself in danger is one of the worst things you can do as Thresh. And the reason why is because you're going into the danger. How are you going to get out? You don't have escapes. Your escape can also be using your hook to escape. You hook some minion and you fly to the minion. But again, like you have a lot of danger. Like, you bring yourself into the danger.
It's a highway to the danger zone.
Jesus. Alright, so due to this, they get Baron. So, the thing that you did there was, like, the first thing is you fought. See this right here? This was not a fight that you should be taking. Back up. We're going back. Back. Further. This wave needs to be larger. Oops. I backed a little too much, but that's fine. So right here, this is okay. If you're going to coordinate a tower dive, do it ASAP. Like, do it. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, yeah. But you should be the one that's tanking, not Ezreal. Like, make sure that he's out of tower range before you drop that ult next time. Getting aggro allows you to make sure that Ezreal takes as little damage as possible. I can't tell if your redemption is actually on cooldown or not. It's not going on cooldown on my screen. But use it whenever you can to sustain your teammates. If you use it during fights, put it at a place where you guys are running. Not a place where you guys are like not going to retreat to. Don't use it as a source of damage. Use it as a source of heal. Just know that it does damage, but just don't treat it as a damage dealing tool.
Treat it
like this right here. Kinda. Okay, like this right here. It just means like you only healed two people, yourself and him, but people were running away, so you should have put it here. And what? Lainer, can you repeat that?
I didn't say anything.
Oh, you were asking us to treat something, because, like, how...
Oh, well, yeah, right. Treat it sort of like Ahri Ultimate, sort of.
Yeah, well, I tell you to treat Ahri Ultimate in the way that it is a gap closer, and it does damage. It's just that the damage part is only relevant if you're quickly assassinating someone, then getting away. In this one, it's like, just because it deals damage doesn't mean you should be using it as a source of counterplaying it for damage. You should be treating the heal as more valuable than anything else. For example, if I use the Ahri ult, I value it as a gap closer, not as a damage dealing source. The only time I value it as a dealing damage dealing source is because, well, I'm out of spells, so I have to ult in to deal damage to kill him. That's it. That's the only reason I'll change it. Like, right. You know what I mean? Like, you have to treat the spell in every single aspect and use which one you need to use the most. Do I need a gap close? Okay, I'm gonna ult that way. Do I need the extra damage from my ult to kill the guy? Well, I'm gonna have to gap close forward and punish him. And then, yeah. As for Ezreal, do I use the Q to, like... Or do I use the Ezreal to buff my... Or Ezreal's W to buff my own attack speed and fly into it forward? Or do I just use it as a form of deceptive play? Because if you use a W first and they dodge the W instinctively, you land the Q. Because they'll dodge the W, even though it does, like, no damage. That's usually how it works.
Me and build full hybrid Ezreal milled with the Muramana.
The problem with W Ezreal is because if you miss one, if you have W and Q as both dealing damage, excuse me, if you miss one, it's a problem. But if you miss W, it's no big fucking deal. Like, as AD Ezreal, if you miss W, so what? That thing does, like, 10 damage. See? Did literally zero damage to fucking Zillion, man. Late heal. That's a decent redemption. But the thing is, nobody gets a healing from it. Except for you, but you're already at full health. Doesn't matter. Lol? Lol?
It was so all calculated.
Defense box, offense box. Defense box applies when you're... your box that you placed was a defense box. However, it was just placed, like, in a poor position. AKA, not next to your carry. Offense box is when you did that. You remember when you fly in and then you flay them back and then you box them? That's an offensive box. Your goal is to cut them off. Box is actually really huge. Some people just drop the box just to drop the box, and that's just called a stasis. Like a middle set. Like, remember when I said I play midfield Thresh, right? It's not an offensive box, but it's not a defensive box, and they can't just walk across it. Lol. 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 Lantern the guy? Use your lantern as a... Treat your lantern as a... This is a gap closer. Like, make it so that their lack of gap closer is, like... Don't forget that it is a gap closer, not just a save me or a shield. Again, triple aspect. That's why the whole Thresh movements thing, you have to think extremely creatively. Like, I never knew that, like, flaying and then looking... Flaying one target, then, like, hooking another target is like, it's the most psychologically deceptive thing ever. You're like, oh, you flay me, obviously I'm gonna get fucked now. And then they flash, and then you actually hook the AD carry, and it's like, well, oops.
And then you box the AD carry and then land.
You pretty much box the AD carry. Yep, you pretty much box the AD carry. That's a correct. But this game was lost when right here, this fight that was taken was not necessary. Second, your bot lane rotation. You notice that bot lane rotation from Lee? You notice that nobody answered? Nobody cared? You guys got that tower for free, then you grouped mid? Pointless, right?
Yeah.
So when I said you had blue, like the value of blue on a support. So think of it like this: when I play jungle, I will never, unless if I'm hard carrying you and you're mid, like if I'm playing with you, if I was jungling and you were mid, and knowing that, and you know that like I'm higher elo and I'll have higher, like different mentality approaching it, I'm gonna take all the blues from you. So like when you actually do get a blue from a blue, like it's valuable, right? It's the same thing as support. You'll never get blue, but judging by the way you play support. And the way most support should be playing support, they cast a lot of spells. Especially when you have 40% CDR, you know? Because right now you've got 10, 20, 30, 30% CDR. And if you have blue, you get 40. So, with that in mind, 40% CDR on Thresh with a ton of mana regen. Hook, 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 hook. Hook, hook, hook. And constantly throwing out hooks. If you manage to land it, hook basically has... It's 8.4 seconds... It should be a little low. Okay, so it's 8.4 seconds. You tug them for... The cooldown gets reduced by 3 seconds when you land it. So it becomes 5.4. But when you hook them, you tug them and it sticks on them for 1.5 seconds. So you actually lose half the duration of it. Over half of the duration of the hook is like the fact that you landed the hook. And you tug them. And you don't even fly in. So the threat of you constantly throwing out fucking strong hooks every 4 or 5 seconds is going to threaten the team. They can't anti-siege against you because they're afraid of getting caught. That's how you zone them out with blue. But instead, you guys you decided to go down bot lane with Lee Sin, who's a terrible Lee Sin. Like, all he did was push. Like, what the fuck? That tower didn't do shit. And then your team is getting... Your team is actually losing a lot of resources mid. Because I don't know, when you showed up, you notice how they were like, you guys were up here. And then they were down here, and Ezreal's out of mana. Like, Ezreal didn't have to run out of mana if you were there, and the reason why if you were there is because he has to spend less mana. If you land your hooks, he'll just land more Qs. You know? So that's good. That's a good sign. So therefore, if you're killing people off instead... Because what he's doing is he's probably trying to, like, shoot people, right? So if he's trying to shoot people and he just keeps missing, then he's gonna run out of mana. And, you know, if you land your hooks, he just shoots people, and if they're dead, he doesn't have to waste mana trying to shoot them because they're dead. Okay. Yeah, somebody needs to recall, that's good. Alright, we're wasting... Alright, first of all, everyone going back is kind of redundant, or kind of bad, but like... There's really nothing else to take... Well, nobody was warning in the jungle. Am I using that word correctly? Redundant. No longer needed or useful. Unnecessary. Not required. Checking if I'm using the word right. Just redundant is kind of like a substitute for retarded, but at the same time it doesn't sound like it's a good substitute for retarded. Okay, so yeah, you don't want to... Okay, so if you look... Okay, yeah, they have no Baron, which means that you guys can fight. Fight. If you're going to fight, try to pick the Zillion off alone. Oh my god. Dude, that's really bad. Lux cooldown might be really short, but if you guys decide to fight, it's going to be really bad. This is how you guys...
That's kind of like why I hate when Ezreal's just use their R to CS. Like, that tilts.
Depends on what they're using it to CS for. Like, if they're using it to defend a wave, that's fine. They're using it to clear a wave in order to guarantee a siege, because your team comp is actually a siege comp, but their team comp is an anti-siege comp. So therefore, it's going to be a stalemate. The reason why they're an anti-siege comp is just because double Zillion Bomb plus Zyra E or Zyra Q will instantly kill the wave. Kha'Zix and Jinx and Fiora being there also help trim the wave too. And your method of clearing the wave is using Lux's mana pool. Hence, Lux having no mana or not having blue is a problem. So, if Lux spends her mana, like, not clearing the wave, you know, and just focusing on harassing or something, spells trouble for your team when you guys get into a team fight. She's at 50%. This is... Okay, first of all, there's four people. You knew somebody's here. You know, there was somebody here. That's... Fiora? No. Wait. One, two,
Kha'Zix.
It was Kha'Zix, okay. Then yeah. This spell, okay, so where you're standing is here. Should be here. If you do Kha'Zix is here, move here next time. I mean, you got stunned, but okay. Bomb's on you, it's gonna pop, whatever. Just move to your move towards your team. Pop your locket, pop your redemption, pop your face to the mountain, don't buy Night's Vow. You should have bought Frozen Heart. Nice hook. Hold the flay until you hold the flay till later. That's how you die, okay. Rip. Sayonara. So Knight's Vow only works if, like, obviously you guys take a lot more damage from it. Frozen Heart would actually just give you a shit ton of armor and mitigate their attack speed. And that's really important, especially cutting off when it comes to Jinx and Fiora. And I believe that's game.
Right.
Yeah. Knight's Vow is still a good item. It's just that I don't value it as much because I value the cooldown reduction on Thresh, who has a lot of mana problems, you know? Like when he's constantly casting spells, hence the 40% CDR. If you build the 40% CDR build and then you get Ninja Tabi, Ninja Tabi would allow you to, or Ninja Tabi would allow you to take less damage, because remember, you don't get armor scaling. So Knight's Vow just, you still take damage, so that's kind of, like, what's the point of that? Like, you know, like Frozen Heart, you still take damage, sure, but Knight's Vow, you split damage between two people, it's like, okay. Next. Face of the Mountain. So, in terms of itemization for that, personally, I think that you still could have gone Talisman. That's for rotations and stuff. But, didn't have to. And then, you also have the hooking syndrome. Like, you know, you don't have to throw the hooks out there to be a threat. Just having the hook itself, it's kind of like a Morgana binding. Just having the hook, or Ahri Charm, just having the Ahri Charm is just a threat. They just have to move really willy-nilly. So, I mean, your team played fine. Lee Sin didn't in the early game. Could have played cleaner. He played fine, it could be cleaner. But with that being the case, your boxes are fine. One box, you remember I told you one box could be positioned a little bit differently, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like just towards the right side more. Your positioning in team fights, a lot of it came down to you flying into your hooks. That's something that you should be refraining from if you're going to play Thresh. You should know when to fly in and when you shouldn't fly in. And the most optimal time I advocate for flying in is when you... You should be flying in when you see that you can land at least, at the very minimum, 3-man flay. No less. No less than 3 unless you're in bot lane and you can guarantee the landing of 2 into a box. You know what I mean? And the reason why you want to guarantee... Because, like, why should you be putting yourself in danger when you're in a team fight? You're literally flying into potentially 5 people. And if you land a 5-man flay, fantastic. But if you get blown up immediately after, like, where's your actual support? Like, from that point, you can't support the team when you're flying in and killing yourself. Like, it's not going to work like that. Hence why if you just hook somebody, tug 1, tug 2, walk up a little bit and flay them backwards, that's a pick. That's one of the things Thresh excels at, especially in the Fog of War. Hence why you should be using your sweeper constantly, buying more control wards to make sure that there's no vision in the bush. As for roaming, this game isn't a good example for me to talk about roaming because, like, you can't roam without having, like, a really confident laning phase. And right here, this is kind of awkward, you know? So it's like pointless to talk about the whole advanced, like, roaming and stuff because, like, you don't understand, like, how to properly lane versus this specific map. Like, she won't let you roam at all. Like, it's fucking Zyra. You're gonna roam? Okay, I'll just slaughter the fucking support 1v1. Slaughter the AD carry 1v1. Oh, my AD carry's here too, so we're just 2v1 with death. Like, you can't roam no matter what. Because if you leave your AD carry alone, he's gonna kill himself. Like, he's just that bad. And then we're gonna proceed on to the next part, which is your skill order. You needed more lanterns, and you didn't treat your lantern as a gap closing tool for your allies. You treat it as like just a shield, as from what I can see. When the Darius attempted to, like, you know, when you were on the Fiora, you could have just lanterned the Darius, because while you're pulling him to the Fiora, you're also pulling him to safety. And the reason why I say that is because he's in the place where, like, where the Fiora is standing, and then, here, let me see. So, illustrating it out, it's like, your blue side, the red side. So, you're standing here, Fiora's standing here, Darius is standing here, the enemy team is potentially here. So, you're pulling him to safety. Because these four, and then, you know, they can do this while you guys are doing this. You know, 2v1ing, right? That makes sense? Right. So that's the creative thought. Like, you probably wouldn't have thought, oh, I'm pulling him to safety. Like, technically you can think, oh, I'm pulling him to safety, but what you're actually doing is you're pulling him to safety and securing this kill, because now he's on top of her instead of being like so far away, this distance, like here, because you were on top of her and now he just has to get on top of her and that's it, and then you pull him away from the enemy threat. This way the next thing that you can do is just 2v1 him and bounce, get the free kill, which is most important. Remember when I told you about getting free stuff, because that's how you get gold and stuff like that, as a support, just taking free kills and stuff, and that's how you carry. And then the next thing is, when it comes to looking at people, like I said, that's, you can do it on every single champion. It's just that every single champion, almost every single champion turns. For example, Ahri, look here, charm this one, straightforward, right? Look mm-hmm. Walk, you can make it even, you don't just have to look either. They're running in a straight pattern, you're running to cut them off, you have the option to slaughter this person. Can you do it? Think in your head about your damage output. If you can't slaughter this person, don't just go for this person. You would turn this way, look directly at them, run towards them, charm.
Yep.
That way. So do the same with Thresh. Walk up. Don't do what I told you to flay this way, then hook this way. That's kind of pointless, and the reason why is because, like, it's all psychological. Like, the people, there will be people that don't even, like, fucking react to the hook, and you just completely miss it, and it's just awful. So, you can just, try to see, other ideas to do it. And the most common thing, again, is to do is just to walk forward, reverse flay this way, they'll put the person closer to you. And remember what I said about skill shots: when you're on top of someone, the likelihood of it missing is rather high. I played an ARAM last night. I don't have the recording because I delete all the ARAM recordings, but basically I knew every single time Lee Sin would do a point blank Q, and because I knew he was gonna do a point blank Q, I would abnormally move to the side, and he would miss every point blank Q, and you just see this energy bolt just fly across the fucking area, and it's just hilarious. But like, you can expect, like, if you, oops, oops. It's like this, and then your hitbox is like, you know what I mean? It's literally on top of them. But like, if you're farther like this, the projectile's travel time gives them enough time for them to react out of the way. Hence, if you're on top of them, what's the reaction time? They literally have to flash, this way. Because your hook is going to be straight. There's no way you could throw a hook this way and predict that. There's almost no fucking way. Because they're on top of you, what's the point, right? So if you're on top of them, they flay, like, they have to flash if they get hit by a flay and you're level 2. You know, and the most other important thing is level 2 power spike on Thresh. It doesn't work in this team, in this game, because like, their level 2 is significantly stronger. Hell, their level 1 is just equally as strong as your level 2, like, because she just does so much fucking damage, Zyra, I mean. So you have to be aware of that. Power spikes, though, they do in fact come from they do in fact come from your level 2. Thresh is extremely threatening when he hits level 2. Excuse me. When it comes to his laning phase, he is strong against like other melees, against those that are immobile, and can do decently well. He's always a really good pick, but it's just how well you know how to play him as a player. So the thing that I see is like you're kind of doing the Ahri thing where it's sort of like you're doing these pointless skill shots in an attempt to hook them and try to make a play, but you have to judge like when that kind of play is necessary if you want to advance forward. And the reason why is because think about it, like if you don't just charm someone like in a giant minion wave, because you're gonna lose that. Like it kind of depends on what you value. Do you value the CS or do you value the kill? Can you actually get the kill is the more important question to ask. And if you do get the kill, does that kill or kills, is that greater than what you could have gotten just by simply laning? So you gotta pick your choice. And if you choose that, if you think that kills are more important, then like, by all means, go for it. It's just kind of a dangerous bout. And the reason why is because if you go for kills, remember that those minions are gonna dick on you, you know, like during the fight. You know what I mean? Like, it's just because they're gonna dick on you, like for sure. And then you're gonna play if you're gonna play a support, Brand's actually a pretty good one. If you're gonna play mage style supports, because Brand's base damages are just obnoxiously high, as well as the fact that he can punish very well.
And I usually play Vel'Koz support.
Vel'Koz support's also pretty good. The only thing is, I've already told you about the rock paper scissors, or I should have told you about the rock paper scissors, but Vel'Koz is punished by hard engagers. Example, Thresh.
Ahri.
Nautilus. Yes, Ahri counts as one too. So you can't just pick him like willy-nilly blind. I'm not sure what else there is to talk about.
Alright, I think that's good enough because I am super tired.
Okay. Well, you know, the drill, this will be up eventually because it's going to be a while before I actually, like, am able to drop it up on the YouTube.
Yeah, I'm in no rush.
Alright.
Alright, thank you.
Okay. I will see you next time. It was actually pretty fun watching this one, and there's a lot of knowledge in terms of psychology here, too, so this is a pretty valuable session, as always. Yeah, I'll talk to you next time.
Alright, see ya. See ya. Thank you.
Alright guys, thanks for watching. This has been Veggie. LOL Veggie at Twitter. Skype is in the corner for coaching. See you guys next time.